In the 90s, Korn dominated the heavy metal charts, but Korn founding member and guitarist Brian Welch was living the lifestyle of both a rock star and a dad. Brian's story of excess, addiction and love is now the subject of a new documentary. We'll speak to him in just a tick, but first, let's have a quick look at Loud Crazy with a K, Love.
And the winner is Korn, Freak on a Leash.
She's cute, huh?
I'm a new person. I'm going to be a great dad.
Today, get down, please.
I'll just have a couple beers.
All of the other kids had their mom and dad come to Mother's Day or Father's Day.
I couldn't stop being bad to my body. I couldn't stop these addictions.
Not that it was a rock and roll.
Please welcome Brian to Studio 10. Yeah. Great to see you.
Thank you very much for having me back.
Before we get to your amazing transformation in life, can you take us back to those heady days when Korn was rocking out in the 90s? Just how wild was it?
It was so wild because, first of all, we all grew up together. So I met the singer in elementary school. And so when we went to high school and regrouped and started getting in bands, it was just like they gave us a career. For we could do anything. They're like, here you go. We're gonna pay you to party like wild animals.
Yeah.
And just, you know, fork out some good songs.
Yeah.
And but it was crazy. It was
you said
wild.
You kept doing bad things to your body. Like what?
Everything. I mean, they're like, okay, what do you want in the dressing room for food? Yeah. It was like Doritos, Jack Daniels, beer, and then we'll tell our roadies, like, get us some cocaine later. Yeah. It was just like everything.
Excess. It's kind of an expectation, though, because if fans heard that you were sipping tea and nibbling on biscuits, they would have a real problem with it, wouldn't they?
They'd be like, you're boring.
Yeah.
Well, it was almost mandatory, wasn't it? Because Korn was formed, like part of the other members came from a band that their lead singer had succumbed to drug addiction and LAPD, and then you struggled as well with...
It was meth. Everybody.
And, like, I mean, it was almost mandatory, wasn't it? Mandatory banditry.
Yeah, and all of our friends in other bands, too, you know? It's just so available. And I think things are different now. You know, they're a little bit better just because people have, you know, matured and grown up. Even the younger bands I see, they're not doing the same things, you know?
How bad did it get for you? Because I read online you were, like, smuggling drugs into deodorant containers or anything you could... get your hands on to because you're so scared of being strung out on tour and stuff like that.
It's so crazy to think about that because it feels like a different person. Like it's not even me, but I was on the Gold Coast and I had a bunch of meth in my bags and I was running out and I was afraid that I was gonna like just crash. And so I had, we went from here to Germany and I had a drug dealer send me through FedEx or the mail or whatever, more meth in Germany. So that's when I was at my worst and I was like, okay, this is the gutter.
Yeah.
This is going a little bit too far,
and
I got to get clean. And so that's when the spark started to just fight for myself.
You've got this sex, drugs, and rock and roll lifestyle. There was sex too, including an addiction to porn that really, really devastated you, didn't it?
Yeah.
And then you have this little girl, this baby daughter, Janaea. How did she fit into your world, and at what point were you when she arrived?
It was crazy because me and her mom were like doing a lot of drugs and partying. And then when she got pregnant, it was like, we're going to do this. We're going to be good parents. Like, we need to stop now. And so that lasted a couple years. And then we started falling back into our things, you know. But it was a thing where I was looking at this perfect little angel, right? Yeah. She looked like Shirley Temple, you know, just curly
beautiful.
Hair running around. And here I was, a monster, you know, behind closed doors. And I'm addicted to porn. And I'm like looking at this little female baby, and I'm like, like, wait, who do I want to be? Do I want to treat women and look at women like this? Or do, you know, I'm raising, one day will be a woman, you know? So it was a tug of war going on, and I needed to wake up.
And so to talk about all of that in this movie, how hard was that? Were there moments for you where you felt guilt, or what sort of emotions have you been through?
Yeah, I wrote my book called Save Me For Myself in 2007. I put all of this in the book, and I'm just like, look, because so many corners, I left the band and I found, you know, my faith and everything, and people were like, oh no, he's a weird Christian now. And I'm like, okay, this is why I left. Everybody hated me. I'm like, this is why I left. And I put it out in the book, and so I saw how many people it helped.
Yeah.
And so then I was like, in the movie, I was like, oh, well, I gotta be real and raw and honest because so many people have been through this and they carry guilt. And I've been, I'm past my guilt. My daughter is, I mean, I regret, but my daughter's like, you are the best father you could be, and you are a great father to me, and she forgives all the mistakes. So.
Wow. Talk us through. And inspired by what you've achieved, yeah. No doubt, too.
I was just going to say, like, obviously, a lot of people would think you're the last person who would become a born-again Christian, but talk us through your sort of, I don't know, your conversion or your finding of faith, because I know a lot of people who have really addictive personalities, and they go from being basically addicted to drugs to addicted to God. Is it that kind of thing? Did you need something to replace the highs that you were getting from drugs, from meth and other stuff?
I think, first of all, I just want to say that, you know, the organized religion thing, I don't like. I love the spiritual atmosphere of the aspect of the Christ within. That's what I do. But as far as, like, you know, what I found, like, the meaning of life in a peace that was so far beyond anything I ever felt and a love that was just so accepting. And I was addicted to that, but I kind of got lumped into the religious, you know, the ones that you hear all this drama and Catholic. I don't want to say different. But I respect all religions. And there's good in all of them and bad in all of them. And just like in humanity. So, but I found that peace within and that's it. It's personal for me.
And you got back with the band.
Yeah.
Yes. So yeah,
you tell us the whole story.
And tell us about that. How different is it being in a heavy metal band now that you're clean? How long have you been sober for?
14 years.
Wow.
Yeah. I tried drinking a couple years ago and it didn't work out too good, so. I was like, I can drink responsibly now. I'm not.
And how is rock and roll when you don't have, you know, the stuff to numb you?
When you
Without
do
the
have
sex and
when
the
you,
drugs.
When you do have a cup of tea back. When you do have a cup of tea backstage.
It is. Oh, you know what it's about now? It's about the music. It's about the show. Yeah, it's about the fans. And it's not about us, me. We're cool and you worship us. It's about let's get together and all, like, go crazy and have fun at the show.
Is the music better now that you and the band are
We playing. Definitely play better.
Yeah.
Definitely play better.
Because it's so interesting. I've read about creative people getting clean. Stephen King, for example, he was a raging cocaine addict and he would write his novels with cocaine and blood dripping out of his nose. And when he got clean, he was like, I don't have any creativity. I can't write. I can't be that amazing writer again. And it took him a few years to get his groove back. Did you find that happened to you as well?
I think so. And I think it was good that I left the band because I went into a solo career and learned a whole new writing process. Mm. And then the other guitar player, Monkey, was left on his own, you know, as the one guitar player. And he was, like, forced to step up and write. And so I think we got better. But it took a little bit because, you know, you're wearing this mask for so many years, you know? So, but, you know, we do grow up as humans, you know, eventually, and we're lucky that we do.
I think Alice Cooper also went clean, found God, and I think now he plays golf. God help us all.
Yeah. you haven't gone to golf.
Have you started playing golf? Good, okay. You say, but is there like a secret society of sort of rehab rock and rollers where you guys sort of talk to each other about what you've been through and...
A little bit, yeah, but I would like to say, you know what, I blend in with everybody. Yeah. I don't want it to be us and them. Then. I'm a Christian and you're not, and I'm sober and you're not. I blend in. People drink around me every day and I don't condemn them. I smell their beer because I love the smell of beer. I just can't drink it. And Alice Cooper, I love him, and we get together with him every once in a while, too.
I know Alice does this. If you see someone in trouble, though, you see someone who's kind of where you were in your world, the music, do you reach out?
100% fans or musicians.
Yeah. Wow.
And with the suicides, you know, they've been ramping up lately. Everyone's checking in a lot more.
That's right.
Hey, man, how you been? I just went to a Metallica show. I haven't seen those guys in like 10 years. And I just want to say hi, you know, and see how everyone's doing. And I do that with all kinds of bands now, and they do it with us. And
what's on your rider now? Is it green tea and bottles of sparkling water backstage?
No brown M&Ms.
That is the best question. We have organic vegetables and fruits. Wow. We have juicers.
That's great.
Have all this stuff. But there is wine and some beer and everything, too, for those that can handle it.
Yeah. And the guests.
I just can't. And the guests, yes. Yeah. They can handle it all.
And you're pretty proud because your beautiful daughter couldn't be here today because she's about to start something very big back home.
Yes. She's going to get her bachelor's degree in creative writing.
Oh, wow.
So she started college literally like 3 days ago.
Wow. Oh, that's awesome.
Super proud.
She's so jealous. She wants to move to Sydney.
Oh. Yeah. We got unis here.
Well, she can swing by anytime.
Come on.
Yeah.
Yes.
Come and live with us. Yeah. That loud, crazy.
We need the cred.
Love releases nationally at Event Cinemas today. Brian, you're a rock star in every sense of the word. Thank you so much.
Oh, my God.
Thanks so much for
My pleasure being here. Thank you all.
Right.